Hello, welcome to our session that prepares you for pre-entry examinations. There are for various universities around the world. This is the particular area of numerical skills. We intend to help you to improve your numerical skills as well as giving all students around the world the required guidance. My name is Norman Nyang, your favorite tutor for mathematics. So we begin the session. I found it quite helpful for us to have an overview how to improve our numerical skills to enable us to pass numerical skill exams. Now the challenge why most students fail numerical skills is because of lack of interest. These are students who maybe have done humanities at the preceding level of education, and so they don't have as much interest. And so if they don't have interest, they avoid the section of numerical skills, which is very often the difference between passing and failing the pre-entry exams for various universities. Whether you're doing pre-entry exams for law or in a related course, it is these tips could be quite important for you. So we'll give you the top tips. The most important is what we are doing. Practice, practice, practice. It is quite important because if you don't do practice, then you're not acquainted with questions. Things like timing, being able to think through the solution in the manner in which the examiner expects you. That is as a result of practice. The other option we find students waste, the other challenge we find students waste a lot of their precious time during the examination. This is quite important. You have to, when you allocate 2 minutes to the question, let it be 2 minutes. If a question is worth 2 marks, there's no point in spending 10 minutes. The other option, use a numerical reasoning. That's an important point for us. You need to improve logic. And then the other one, which I think rather should have been the first, keep an eye on the clock. This is a bit related to the second point. So we begin our session with a look at 10 important questions, which I compiled through in this first session of preparation for pre-entry examination for various universities around the world. The first of these is a question which I would consider as a logic question. Alice pointed to a lady in the photograph and said, her son's father is the son-in-law of my mother. Here's the question. How is Alice related to the lady? So they're asking us, how is Alice related to the lady in the photograph? Alice said her son's father is the son-in-law of my mother. So here are the options, many options as usual. There's only one correct option in the pre-entry. So the first of these is the one, the relationship with Alice. Is this lady an aunt to Alice, a sister, a mother, or a cousin? What would be the solution? If they say her son's father is her husband. So this is like saying her husband is the son-in-law of my mother. So my mother calls her husband the son-in-law. So this straight away means we share a mother. And so the lady is my sister. Here is the explanatory solution. Husband is married to my mother's daughter. So anyone who is married to my mother's daughter is effectively my sister. As such, the husband is married to my sister, and so the lady is my sister. Simple and straightforward. So the option B was the correct answer. We go to our next question. And this looks at probability. Often with pre-entry exams, there's a mix-up, a bit of this, less of that, a bit of that, but it would be quite rewarding if you are willing to think, because the points for numerical skills are normally higher than those for the the other sections like logic and general knowledge and comprehension, among others. So here is the second question. The probability of an event can be, the first is negative 0.7. We know probability is between 0 and 1, so it can't be a negative number. We can use elimination method to remove the first. The second one is 11 over 9. 11 over 9, if we divide with our calculator, is a number more than 1. Probability cannot be more than 1, so we disown this option. Part C, 1.001 is a number more than 1. Part D is 0.6, which is the only number between 0 and 1. And so the answer is D. Normally, the option of none of the above is normally not so applicable. But again, a student who is ill-prepared may decide to take one of these options. But again, it's very rare. The examiner will give you a question and fail to give you the answer. So we look at the explanatory notes. Probability is always between 0 and 1, as we said, so can never be negative. We can also add, can never be a number more than 1. We can look at the third question. A person's present age is 2/5 of the age of his mother. So this is a mother-son relationship. After 8 years, he will be half of the age of his mother. So right now is 2/5 of the mother's age. When we add 8 years to each of them, it will be half of the mother's age. How old in years is the mother at present? So we have we have 5 options as usual. So we have to do a computation. So we can look at the solution. Supposed to be son and mother. Sorry, we put their daughter, but you can proceed. We have a question, question 3. So here is the illustration. We begin by a graphical illustration. Let the mother's age today be X. If the mother's age is X, we were told that a person's age is 2/5 of the mother's age. So if the mother's age is X, the son's age is 2/5 of X. 2/5 of X. After 8 years, each of them will be 8 years older. As such, the son will be 2/5 plus 8. The mother will be X plus 8. You can look at the question again. After 8 years, he will be half the age of the mother. So after 8 years, it means when you multiply the son's age by 2, we get the mother's age. And that is the mathematical equation. So we have twice into the son's age after 8 years is equal to the mother's age after 8 years. So we are able to solve this by opening brackets, multiplying 2 into 2/5 of x and multiplying 2 into 8. So we have 4/5 of x plus 16. Is equal to x plus 8. Collecting like terms, putting x together, will have us taking 1x this side and taking 8 the other side. So we have 8 is equal to 8 over 5x, and x is equal to 40. Now remember, x is the mother's age today. So x is equal to 40. X is equal to 40. What is our question? How old in years is the mother at present? So the mother is 40 years old. So our answer is C. You can look at the fourth question. Two clocks are set at the same time. One is seen to gain 40 seconds and the other is seen to lose 50 seconds in 24 hours. So every 24 hours, one clock gains 40 seconds, the other loses 50 seconds. So if one is gaining 40 seconds and the other is losing 50 seconds, it means they are 90 seconds apart. The difference being created after 24 hours is 90 seconds. One is gaining 40 seconds, the other one is losing 50 seconds. So every 24 hours, there is a difference of 90 seconds. So the question, in how much time will they show a difference of 15 minutes? so we can look at the solution, a rather short solution. So in 24 hours, they lose 90 seconds on each other, as per our explanation. So in 15 minutes, how many days will come out of 15 minutes? 15 minutes is 15 times 60 seconds. So if we want to know how long it takes to create 15 minutes, we shall have 15 minutes times 60 seconds over 90 seconds, because this is what comes in a day. After a day, after 24 hours, they lose 90 seconds. And as such, when you compute that, you come out with 10 seconds. Question number 5. If L denotes division, M denotes multiplication, P denotes addition, and Q denotes minus subtraction, then which of the following is true? Which of the following is true? So we have to basically replace this and see which one is true to give us the correct. For example, 32 P L 16 Q 16 simply means 32 plus 8 divided by 16 minus 4. So we have to compute all this and see which one is correct. We can look at the solution. So the first one is 32 plus 8 divided by 16 minus 4, which is 28.5. The next one is 6 multiplied by 18 minus 26 divided by 13 plus 7 is equal to 113. The next one, 11 times 34 divided by 17 minus 8 divided by 3. And then the next one is 9, adding 9 to 9, then dividing by 9, minus 9 times 9. Now this may not be so complicated, because you can get it even if you use your calculator. You can use your calculator to derive at the final answer. But this is an application of body mass. But if you have a scientific calculator, you can just punch in and get which of those gives you the correct answer. So according to our computation, it is only this one which is correct. All the others are wrong. So the applicable answer in this case would be negative 71. And as such, our answer will be part D. You can look at question number 6, rather statement problem, which you need to convert into words, an equation, solve and come up with a solution. If one third is added to one third of a number, the result is half the number. What is the number? You can form equations. So as usual, let the first number be x, because it is our unknown. So if a third, which is one third, which is a numerical number, plus one third of a number, so one third of x is equal to a half of the number, so is equal to a half x, and that is our equation, which when we solve, collecting like terms as usual, taking a third that side, we have a half minus a third, which is 1 over 6x is equal to a third. And so by cross multiplication, we have 6, multiply 6 by 1, we have 6, 3 by 1, we have 3x, 6 is equal to 3x, and as such, x is equal to 2. So we go back to our solution. So the only answer having 2 is D. So that's our question 6. You can look at question number 7. A train wagon can carry 24 adults or 30 children. So the wagon can either carry 24 adults or it can carry 30 children. If 25 children are already on the train, what is the largest number of adults that can still get on the train? So instead of 30 children, they have told us we have 25 children. So there is a space missing for 5. There is a space for 5 children. But they want us to replace that space with 5 adults. So it's like they're asking us, in the space of 5 children, how many adults can go there? What is the largest number of adults that can still be on the train wagon in addition to the 25 children? Here is our solution. 24 adults or 30 children. So this is the ratio. If 25 children are present, we now have to find the number of adults. So if 25 children are present, we want to get what ratio of 5 relates to adults. And so we simplify this ratio 24 to 30. When we divide by 6 and by 6, we get 24 divided by 6 is 4, 30 divided by 6 is 5, 4 to 5. So meaning you can either take 4 children, 4 adults or 5 children. So in the space for 5 children, we replace with 4 adults. And therefore, 4 adults will take the space of the 5 children. Simple and logical. So we go back to our answer, and the correct answer is C, which is 4. We can look at question number 8 as we move towards the end of our 10 questions chosen for today's session. Question number 8. The average of a group of 30 children is 30. The average of a group of 70, The average of a group of 30 numbers is 30. The average of a different group of 70 numbers is 70. The two groups of numbers are combined into a single group. So we have two averages. What is the average of the combined numbers? We have all sorts of answers as usual. We can look at the computation. As always, we know average is a relationship between the total and the total number. Therefore, total is the product of average times the number. So the first set, the total shall be equal to the average of 30 times the number 30, which is 900. For the second set, total is equal to 70 times 70, which is 4,900. So the total for the two sets is 900 plus 4,900, which is 5,800. So the total for the total number for the two sets is of course 30 plus 70, which is 100. And so the average is 5,800 divided by 100, which is 58. And then this is our answer. Of course, even without calculation, I would straight away discard some of these options, because I expect the average to be a number between 70 and 30, since we are combining two different averages. So it cannot be 100, it cannot be 5,800, it cannot also be none of these. So, but the most important thing is to do it logically. We can look at question number 9. Suppose 5 days before the day tomorrow was Wednesday, what day of the week was yesterday? So 5 days before the day tomorrow was Wednesday. So if I said 5 days before the day tomorrow was Wednesday, so even if I have my calendar, I have maybe 2 weeks, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, running up to Sunday for 2 weeks. If I say 5 days before the day tomorrow was Wednesday, so 5 days before was Wednesday, I may as well look at this as 5 days after Wednesday. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is 5 days after Wednesday, because they were telling us 5 days before was Wednesday. So 5 days after Wednesday is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It is Monday. Let us look at the question again. Suppose 5 days before the day tomorrow was Wednesday. So 5 days after Wednesday was tomorrow. What day of the week was yesterday? Straightforward. So if 5 days after was Monday, and this Monday is the day tomorrow, meaning that today is this date, which is Saturday. And therefore, the question is asking us what day of the week was yesterday. So yesterday was the day before today, which is Saturday. So yesterday was Saturday. And our answer here would be B. So we can look at our final question, which is question 10 in this preparatory session for numerical skills in the pre-entry exams. If x is divided by y, the result is 3 over 4. So x divided by y is 3 over 4. If y is divided by z, the result is 5 over 6. We are moving with the question. What is the result when x is divided by z? So they have given us relationship between x and y.
And I've also jumped to give us a relationship between Y and Z. And now they want us to find a relationship between X and Z. This is a typical basic application of ratio analysis. So X over Y is 3 over 4. And Y over Z is 5 over 6. So X to Y is 3 to 4. Y to Z is 5 to 6. So we are tasked with finding X to Z. So we express Y in a common ratio because Y is what exists in both. So we want to get a common ratio for Y using the LCM for the given two ratios. And the given two ratios, where there is Y here, first of all is 5, and again where there is Y here is 4. So LCM of 5 and 4 is 20, which is literally 5 times 4. So when we express X to Y, to make this factor 20, we multiply by 5. So 3 to 4 divided by 5, we get 15 to 20. And then to make this 5 a 20, we multiply by 4. So 5 to 6 multiplied by 4, which is 20 to 24. And so we have a common factor of 20 in all these three ratios, meaning we can express them linearly. So X to Y to Z is 15 to 20 to 24. And so if I want to get X to Z is rather 15 to 24. And as such, reducing with a common factor of 3 gives us the ratio 5 to 8. So that brings us to the end of this session, preparing us for numerical section of the pre-entry exams. My name is Norman Inya, your favorite tutor. If you like this video, you can subscribe to my YouTube channel so that you can get the latest videos that we post. Thank you so much.